My name is Diana Maria Delfna Myers, Granados Malinard, Lyman Jinks de Borges. It's a very long name, and usually you can't put it all on an application. Most of my friends call me Diana. I'd like that. I was born in Hollywood, California, July 3rd, 1961. I'm the eldest of four girls born to a beautiful and strong Mexican woman and a hard-working American boy from California. I was born only 2 weeks on this side of the border. My mom had some problems getting her papers. She was so proud when she arrived in this country that when she came here, she wouldn't speak her native tongue. She wanted to learn English. So as she learned English, so did I. And I guess that explains my kind of quirky accent and the way I speak. I lived in Southern California for 25 years, but I never really did feel like I belonged there. I would dream of mountains and trees and rivers and big skies. I guess I always considered myself, and still do, a country girl. Well, my dream came true in 1986. That's when I moved to the Lake Tahoe and Carson Valley area. It was beautiful here, and I've never regretted a day. In 96, I met my husband, Dwight Borges, and I started working with the Borges Family Carriage and Sleigh Rides in Lake Tahoe. And I started doing pony rides and wagon rides, and it also got my start in performing. I would give historical tours on my carriages and sleighs. A teacher heard me perform and or give a tour. I'm not sure what's the difference. But she asked me if I would do a Chautauqua for her classroom of Sarah Winnemucca. That was probably one of the most amazing offers I have ever had, and it's taken me down a path of great rewards. I also, through my love of the family, thought it was important that the stories, especially of their patriarch, Sam Borges, who started the carriage and sleigh rides in 1967, that his stories not be lost. So together, we wrote and published a book of his memoirs called The Memoirs of Sam Borges, A Sleigh Ride in Lake Tahoe. Since then, I have performed and worked with historical societies, social groups, performed at the governor's inaugural ball, state fairs, cowboy poetry. My life has just been a wonderful path and very rewarding, and I'm most grateful. Our family motto is strive to be happy. I'll tell you, sometimes that's not always an easy thing to do, but definitely worthwhile. Sometimes you have to look for those little bits of color in what could be a gloomy day. You know, maybe it's a smile or helpful advice or definitely a kind word from even a stranger. But no matter what you do to try to find happiness, no matter how you strive to accomplish it, it's For me, it's what's made my life a blessing. No matter what has happened, I've always been happy. I've always tried. And at the end of the day, I always try to remember those little things that make me happy. I found one good way to get a smile from someone. If you offer a compliment, you'll get a smile from them. That's a guarantee. I think it's worked in my life. And I guess the best part of this journey on the good red road that I have taken is that really what I like best about it is just life. It's been the journey. Not all the little points, they're great, but life is what's the best. Well, my childhood memories are not necessarily pleasant ones. You know, I did have some wonderful times. We had camping trips as a family, and I really loved it when distant relatives would come to visit. I really liked that. And I had this wonderful music teacher. You see, we had a baby grand piano. Yes, it was a big piano and took up a good majority of the living room. And my mother insisted that we have lessons. And the teacher, I don't know, she saw something in me. And she taught me how to use my voice properly. However, most of my young life and that of my sisters and my mother, as well as even my father, our lives were filled with violence, sexual abuse, loneliness, and a lot of disappointment. I started off well. I went to a good school, Notre Dame Academy. I really loved to read, but I wasn't very good at it. I wasn't a great student. But I remember our local library. I loved going there because I could read about different places and escape the terror of what I was living through. I could be anyone, anywhere. And it was a wonderful escape for me. In fact, when I was small, I used to really believe that I was the lost daughter of a fairy queen. Sometimes I still believe I am. I left home at 15. I never did finish school. I got mixed up with the wrong people. And I had my first child at the age of 17. A lot of people will say that I lost so much of my childhood and then became a mother so young. But you know, that baby girl, she saved my life. She really did. Because I wanted more than anything to break the cycle. But unfortunately, I didn't know how to live a normal life. I really had no examples. It seemed to me, though, that if you want something badly enough and you work towards it and you pray that you can see those things happen your dreams can come true. You know, the dream started to come true with a trip I made. I was going up to the northern coast of California to visit one of my sisters. I had my then 5-year-old daughter, and I was pregnant with my second child. I wanted so desperately to move out of Los Angeles. It just wasn't for me. And I wanted to find a new home. But I want you to know, the Emerald Triangle was not the place for me. So what I decided was I was going to drive east across the state to South Lake Tahoe and check out Lake Tahoe. And then I would catch the 395 and then travel down that way to Los Angeles. Once I came, didn't even see the lake, just the trees and the mountains. Instantly, I knew that this was the place of my dreams. So, when I got up there, I looked around and I found a job and an apartment and a little school that would help me with my children. I drove home, I kissed my mom goodbye, and I have never regretted living in this beautiful area, not a single day, not even on the hottest, driest, windiest days Nevada could throw at me, did I ever regret moving here. I lived first in Lake Tahoe, like I said. That was 1986. I was the mother of a spunky 5-year-old girl, Rhiannon Marie. The child, the second one, turned out to be a gallant son, Christian Edward. And by 1991, when I actually moved permanently into Carson Valley, I had two more children, a very talented Austin James and another beautiful daughter, Veronica Arlene. Now I'm in my 50s. I have 3 grandchildren and more on the way. My relationships with the children's fathers didn't turn out so very well. I've got to admit, my problem isn't that I haven't loved, but maybe I've not always loved so wisely. So in 96, I fell in love with this tall, dark, handsome man, Dwight Borges. He was sitting on a carriage, and I had a job where I would walk past him every day, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times a day. After I got to know him, I started to realize that he was so very different from anyone I had ever met in my entire life. It didn't take very long before we became the best of friends, lovers, and eventually husband and wife. My life with him has been is the greatest blessing that has ever happened to me. My children by far were the most wonderful gift, but Dwight, he was a blessing. And the adventures that we have shared together, I couldn't have even imagined in my wildest dreams. He helped me to raise my 4 children. He encouraged me to go back to school and not just get my GED, but to get a degree, which I did in early childhood development. seemed logical with four kids. He taught me to love the big, beautiful Belgian draft horses and the family business. He taught me the ropes and he made me his partner. And we have operated the family business ever since. We've traveled the world together. I only have one continent left, one of the A continents. Some people think Africa, oh, it must be Antarctica, but I've already been there. What a wonderful place. No, I have Australia left to do, hoping to get there and be able to claim that I have stepped on all the continents of the world. Dwight and I have shared friends and families, a hopeful vision of the future, and a fearless desire to not just challenge ourselves, but to express our true feelings, not just about life, but about our love for this area and the people where we call home. Thank you, Dwight. As you probably know, his family operates the Borges family sleigh and carriage rides. It's been a family business since 1967, and we've added wagon rides and pony rides. We do weddings, and we offer guided tours. I prefer the historical ones. And I've been doing these in Genoa, Carson Valley, Carson City, Reno, Mammoth. I've gone out in Fallon, of course, South Lake Tahoe, North Lake Tahoe, and all the way around. I've really enjoyed sharing my love of this area with thousands of people from all over the world. I've been known as the Pony Lady, or even Gizmo's mom. And I know I've made hundreds of children happy sharing with them this marvelous creature, the horse. Dwight and I firmly believe that we have one of the most wonderful jobs in the entire world, because our job is just to make people happy. Who could ask for more? Well, in 2008, Dwight's father, he was 86 years old, took ill. And I knew that his stories just couldn't be forgotten. I would say to him, you should do something, you should write them down. And he would say, well, I can't write any faster than typing like this, so I just don't know if I could do it. And I said, oh, I'll help you, Sam. Little did I know, saying that you'll help somebody write a book means that you will write the book. It was really scary for me. I felt like here's my life being exposed permanently in print. It was scary. And I knew it was going to be a lot of work. I would wake up at 4 a.m. so that I could write for a couple hours and then start my regular life at 7. And in the afternoon, we would meet up and he would tell me all his little stories and I'd put it down on the tape recorder. I knew it was important to do, not just for Sam, but it was like giving back to that little neighborhood library when I was a kid that I loved so much. And it felt like it was going to be such an honor to be amongst all those other authors that brought me such joy. I did join those ranks. I'm the author of Memoirs of Sam Borges, A Sleigh Ride in Lake Tahoe. And of course, it's the biography of our patriarch of the sleigh rides. He started it in 1967. I really felt also that I owed Sam and Rosie Borges so much. Not only did they provide for me a wonderful husband, but they were always supportive and so accepting of me here, a single mom of four children and a whole lot of baggage. But also, they helped the one missing element I had in my life. They showed me what a normal family was like. Oh yes, they had their problems and disagreements and, you know, all that, but was nothing like the way I was raised. My husband went to school and was practically born in the same house. They still live there today. He went to the same schools in the same areas. And the way the family gets together, the way they care for each other, it was a real lesson. And I appreciated that hard work. So writing the book was a way to say thank you. It was a labor of love. And also, it was a major, I think, contribution to the area so that they wouldn't forget one of their own. Yeah, as I've said, my children by far were my greatest gifts, but Dwight and his family was a blessing for me, my life. And it was also a great honor that I was able to give the man, Sam Borges, in his last month of life, a book where he could be proud of his accomplishments and his life. So when he left this planet, I believe that he was truly happy and proud. So in 2005, that's when I was given another great opportunity that has brought me much joy. A school teacher had come on one of my tours, and she had offered me the opportunity. She said she would like me to do a Chautauqua Sarah Winnemucca. And I thought, a what? Of who? I was a bit embarrassed, or I should say I'm embarrassed now, to say that I considered myself a historian. Historian, there's that English language gets to me. Historian. And I didn't know who this woman was. I really was embarrassed. And after a lot of research, very careful consideration in prayer, I did perform Sarah for that classroom. And I still perform at that classroom for her. I've been performing a Chautauqua of Sarah Winnemucca for almost 10 years now. I am always surprised by people's reactions to her story and how I portray her. I really admire not only her love for her people and this land, but even for these new people who were coming across, and her true love and compassion trying to make things work out She works so hard to try to change public opinion from hate to love. And she was so humble. Even though she was a proud woman, she was very humble in her love of her duty. I admired that. And it's been quite an amazing adventure going down the path of being Sarah Winnemucca. I find it really hard to really find the correct words in just a few minutes to say how amazing this journey has been. And I've been asked if I would write a book about my life as Sarah Winnemucca. I think I will do it. We'll see. But I'm pretty sure I'll write it. So as I said, I've been portraying Sarah Winnemucca for about 10 years now. Her struggles, her love. I've performed for the governor at his inaugural dinner, the Genoa Cowboy Festival. I've been at numerous Nevada 150 sesquicentennial celebrations, state fairs. I've performed for numerous visitors to the area, tour groups, social groups, historical societies and such. And of course, my main desire and truly the best part of performing Sarah is when I bring her to the schools. And as I said, I've performed in counties all over the northwest part of Nevada and been in California a couple times as well. I think that it's one of my other great attributes or contributions to this area. Because you see, when I first started doing Sarah, I would walk in and people would say, "Oh, Pocahontas, Sacagawea." Not anymore. When I go into a school, they know it's Sarah. And a lot of times I walk down the road. I remember one story where a gentleman had said, "Oh, hi," or "ho," or "Pocahontas." And some little child, oh, maybe about 10 years old or so, go, "That's not Pocahontas. That's Sarah Winnemucca." I went and hugged him and gave him a free book. I feel I'm making a difference. Her story shouldn't be forgotten. Her hard work for this area shouldn't be lost in the travelings of time. It's my dream and my desire for the future that I can take Sarah back to Washington, D.C. so that I could share her story with the nation. I think the nation should remember people like Sarah Winnemucca. I think it would help them to remember and learn, but more importantly, I really think it would help with the nation's healing. I found that I really enjoyed performing. So my husband, Dwight, and I continued to perform with the Carson Valley Community Theater. So I had to write this part down because it's a big, long list. Dwight and I both were in the production of The Night of January 16, and I was a dwarf man named Mike in Snow White Goes West, the fairy godmother in Hocus Pocus. I've been a member of the ensemble for Just Call Me Madam. I also did, Dwight and I both performed in many of the summer melodramas, which benefited the Dangberg Ranch. Those are so much fun and I love them. I also have participated in Genoa and Gardnerville, Minden, Carson Valley area ghost walks. And One of the historians in Genoa, she said she was going to put me down in the archives as Genoa's hoot. Now, that's not a kick in the pants. I'm also an active member in, here's where I have to read off the list, the Theater Living Legends of Virginia City, Nevada Women's Historical Project, the Douglas County Historical Society. I've been involved with many chambers and visitors authorities, the Arts Council, the Reno Tahoe Carson Valley Tourism. I'm a member of the Wedding and Honeymoon Association, a supporter of the Stewart Indian School, the Youth Family Services, Big Brothers, Big Sisters, Boys and Girls Club, the Boys and Girls Scouts of America. I'm also a member and grateful to the people at St. Gall's Church here in the Valley, as well as St. Teresa's in South Lake Tahoe. I gotta give a big thank you to the people, and I always say this wrong, but that Lake Tahoe Community Church on Kingsbury, some of the sweetest people I've ever met. I've supported local schools, and I've got to tell you, I feel that it's my support and support of all of these things have been a penance compared to the support and love that this community has given back. I'm so very grateful. As I said, I am a world traveler. I only have one more continent. Looking forward to that. I love arts. I love music. I really love gardening. I'm a backyard gardening enthusiast. I wanted to be a farmer, but I don't think I can do that. It's not big enough, I was told. I love being in nature. I love being with people. And Dwight and I both feel that the most important thing one can do in their life, especially my children are raised and grown, having families and doing things on their own, is that we start to give back to the community that we love. Whether it's working hard, volunteering, or just simply smiling, hopefully to put a smile on someone else's face, make their day. I'm grateful for all that I have done and all that I have received and what I have become. And I have many people to thank for that. I'm so amazed at how my life had turned out. And I think that it's important that people remember that you should never stop believing in yourself. Never give up. Strive to be happy. It's not always easy, I know. But there are so many little things you can do, whether it's to find a little color in a gloomy day, or appreciate a small thing that a person says or does for you. Even a smile can really make your day. And I think also what's really important is that at the end of the day, you recall all those things and be grateful for them. I found that one sure way to get a smile out of someone is to offer a compliment. I tried to get 3 compliments a day. And at least at the end of the day, I know I've made 3 people smile, and it's given me as much as I gave. And that's helped me. And it's made my life worthwhile. I'm asked a lot of times with all that I have done and all that I've accomplished, what's the best? That's a hard question. Because my journey on this good red road isn't about the road. It's about the journey. And if you were to ask me what I think is best about my life, I would have to say, just life.